Would you pray with me? Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for making a way that we could enter into your presence. And that as we gather here in your name, that you are present with us. And my prayer is that each one of our hearts would be open to what you've prepared for us to receive this day. And that our hearts would be open to just a touch of your love and your power that's at work transforming this world, and that today it might even transform our lives as we gather here in your presence. And so we give you thanks for the ability for all that to take place, and we do it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning. Happy Labor Day Sunday. Is that a thing? I don't know. It is now. We are so, so glad that you're here this Labor Day weekend. And yesterday, I was telling someone at the last service, yesterday is just a good day for football for our church. One of my daughters asked me, she said, who do you pull for, Dad? I said, I pull for a happy church every Sunday. And we have a happy church today, so that's a good deal. We are glad that you are here, and let me just say a special welcome. If you're here for the very first time, we are so glad. I was talking again to someone after the first service who was here exactly like I often say, because someone invited them and they responded to that invitation. So for those of you who make invitations, thank you for inviting people. And for anyone who may have responded and decided a Labor Day weekend would be a good day to check us out, we are glad that you are here. We'd love to tell you more about us. Hopefully you got a study guide like this when you came in. And the very last page of it has a little card that you can tear out. And later in the service, you can either put it in an offering bucket, or even better, take it out these doors to our group's desk. And there are people there who just love to tell you more about the church, and they have a gift they'll give you. And we're just glad you're here, and we hope that you feel at home. We want everyone to feel at home and to feel welcome, and you can help us do that by greeting one another. So just find someone maybe that you haven't spoken to yet and tell them that you had a really good Saturday and ask them if they did. And if you're watching online, maybe you're away this Labor Day weekend, we are so glad you get to plug into Mountaintop this way. Let us know where you're watching the service from and who you're watching the service with. The video that just finished playing up on the center screen, take you back to science in high school, anybody? We're starting a series next week, and we're going to be talking about building the right elements into our lives. So you get it? Yeah, thank you, Zach. That didn't work any better last hour either. Anyway, it's a series that we're wrapping up our series on Jeremiah this morning. And we're going to begin next week a new series called What Really Matters. And we're going to be talking about truly the kind of elements that we build into the character of our lives and how we want to build hearts that look like Jesus's heart as we live a life that reflects his. And so we're going to be talking about things like integrity and courage and joy and self-discipline and what it means to have a servant's heart. And it's going to be a really practical series of how to shape our hearts and to apply that to our lives. We're convinced, I'm convinced, this is going to be a great series to invite friends to come and be a part of. If you've been around here, we have a vision to be a church that is learning and sharing Jesus's better way to live. And an invitation to a series like this is a great way to get to share that. So we've got these invite cards that you may have seen already. They're at stands as you are leaving this morning. Let me challenge you, encourage you. Take a stack of these and just carry them around with you. And I'm convinced if you'll do that, that God will present opportunities throughout the course of your week to just extend an invitation to someone to join us here on the mountaintop and to discover what really matters in their life. And so use these cards as a way of making that invitation. And again, that series begins next Sunday morning. Wednesday evening, where I said this last week, kind of shifting the way we do Wednesdays. Last week we had a night of a Wednesday night of praise and worship and prayer and communion. This Wednesday and for the rest of the month, we're going to have teaching, and we're real excited. Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker is going to do a study for us on the Feast of Israel. And so that's at 6:30 this Wednesday evening. evening. So a lot of exciting stuff coming up this fall. But before we get to all that, we have to wrap up this series on Jeremiah. And so our ushers are going to come forward in a moment, and this is a chance each week that we have to give back to God in thankfulness of the gifts he's entrusted to us, to invest ourselves in the work that God is doing, to tell his story here on the mountain and off the mountain in places in Birmingham and around the world. We've got a team in Bogota, Colombia this morning that are part of that, and your gifts help make all of that possible. As the ushers are coming forward, and as we're doing that, as we're giving back, and we always say this, if you're new here, it's absolutely okay not to give. We don't want anyone to give pressure, ever feel pressure to give. But when you give, know those gifts really do make a difference. As we're giving, the band's going to do a song that has been kind of a theme song for us throughout this Jeremiah series. It's been part of the little video that we used before the message each week. And they performed it for us earlier in the summer, and it just seemed a crime to let the series end without having a chance to do the song one more time. It's by a band called Civil Twilight. And our series has been God's Truth Speaking to Power, and this song reflects a little bit of that in it. So as we get back to God, listen to these words. Let this be a reminder to you of some of the things that we have learned as Jeremiah has spoken God's truth to powers throughout the summer.
Hold me here.
Thanks, guys. Thanks. Thanks, Shay. Thank you. Let's pray together. Lord, we'd ask you to take these gifts as we return them to you. And Lord, do with them what you always do. Bless them, multiply them, use them to help us tell this story of a God whose love is coming back to us, a love that is changing the world even now. And Lord, use these gifts to help us tell that story on the mountaintop, off the mountaintop, in places all around the world. And as we continue to hear your story this morning through the prophet Jeremiah, Lord, I pray that you would have our hearts open to the truth, that you would speak to the powers in our life, the truth that you would speak of the life that you hold out for us, this life that is truly life. And so open our hearts to hear those truths in ways that we can apply them to our lives even today. For we ask that in Christ's name, and we ask it for his glory alone. Amen. Well, it's kind of hard for me to believe. I looked at it on the calendar this week. We started this series on Jeremiah the last Sunday of May, and we have been making our way slowly and steadily through it throughout the course of the summer. And today we come to the last week in the series, and so if you want to follow along, we're in the last chapter of Jeremiah, chapter 52. And if you don't have a Bible, there are always some Bibles you can pick up at the doors when you come in, and if you don't own a Bible, just keep it. That's just a gift for you. And if you're using the study guide, we are finally in week 15 of the study guide, and we're going to wrap up our series on Jeremiah this morning. What we've seen throughout the story is that Jeremiah tells us about the kingdom of Judah, people a lot like you and me, people who had become tempted to kind of trust in worldly powers to save them when it appeared that everything around them was going to fall apart. And what we've discovered, this is kind of a central truth that we've seen throughout the series, is that the only power to control the destiny of nations or people is God's power. But Judah had to learn that lesson the hard way. And we ask a question the first week in the series. We talked about it again last week, and we've touched on it throughout the 15 weeks. And the question is simply this one: what power do I trust? When you think about your life, where do you place your trust? What power are you trusting in? Not what power should you trust, because we're all in church and everybody knows that when you're in church, the right answer is God's power. But what power do I really trust? When I look at the way I live my life, when I look at the things that I give value to, the things that I make priorities, the ways in which I spend my time and the ways in which I spend my money, where is it that I really place my trust? What power am I trusting in? Now, Judah, and we've seen this through over the weeks, Judah put all of their power, all their trust in powers like political alliances. They'd make an alliance with Egypt, and that wasn't working out, and then they switched to Babylon, or then they might switch back to Egypt again. They kind of believed if they could get their politics just right, that would save them, that would protect them. Sometimes they would put their power in religious practices, but for them it was mostly just going through the motions. Their hearts weren't in it. Their hearts certainly weren't really changed. Sometimes they'd put their power in chasing after foreign gods, believing that they might save them. But what they discover is that none of those things had the power to save. And they keep turning their back on the God whose power could save them, a God who keeps inviting them to return, to come home to him. They keep turning their back on God. And Jeremiah warns them of the consequences of what's going to happen when they do that. But they don't listen. And so we get to the very last chapter of Jeremiah, and in a sense, he wraps up the story of here's what happens to people who turn their back on God. Begins this way, verse 1. Zedekiah is the last king of Judah. Zedekiah was 21 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 11 years. His mother's name was Hamutal, daughter of Jeremiah, completely different Jeremiah, by the way. Daughter of Jeremiah, she was from Libna. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, just as Jehoiakim, the king before him, had done. It was because of the Lord's anger that all this happened to Jerusalem and Judah. And in the end, God thrust them from his presence. Now Zedekiah rebelled against the king of Babylon. So in the ninth year of Zedekiah's reign, on the 10th day of the 10th month, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, marched against Jerusalem with his whole army. They encamped outside the city and built siege walls all around it. And then the following verses, if you have it open, you can kind of just scan through it. The following verses go on to describe what happens as Israel, Judah, the people of Judah get surrounded by the armies of Babylon. And there's this famine that takes place within the city, and it's just devastating. And eventually the armies of the Babylonians, they break through the walls of the city. And Zedekiah attempts to escape, but he's captured and he's carried off as a prisoner. His sons are executed before him, and then they gouge out Zedekiah's eyes. Just gross. And then he is thrown in shackles and thrown in prison, where eventually he's going to die. And back in Jerusalem, the same sort of destruction is taking place. Skip down to verse 12. It says, on the 10th day of the 5th month, in the 19th year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, Nebuzaradan, commander of the imperial guard, who served the king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem. He set fire to the temple of the Lord, the royal palace, and all the houses of Jerusalem. Every important building he burned down. The whole Babylonian army, under the commander of the imperial guard, broke down all the walls around Jerusalem. Nebuzaradan, the commander of the guard, carried into exile some of the poorest people and those who remained in the city, along with the rest of the craftsmen and those who had deserted to the king of Babylon. But Nebuzaradan left behind the rest of the poorest people of the land to work the vineyards and the fields. You get a picture of what's happened here? Everything that Jeremiah has prophesied would happen has taken place. Jerusalem is destroyed. The city's in ruins, just rubble. The walls are torn down. The temple is torn down. The palace has been burned to the ground. There's nothing but destruction. Everything and everyone of any value has been taken off into exile, into Babylon. That included all the gold and silver and bronze pieces that were used in the temple. Everything has been taken off now to Babylon. The only thing left behind are a few of the poorest of the poor who are left there just to continue the agriculture. Everything that Jeremiah had warned the people, if you turn your back on God, here's what's going to happen to you. It's now happened. And it's kind of the end of the story. And then you get to the very last paragraph. And it's kind of a peculiar way to end the book of Jeremiah. Let me read it for you. It starts down in the 31st verse. And it jumps ahead 37 years. Before I read it, think about that for a moment. This is 37 years later. That means that there were people who had been taken off into exile who have died and are buried there. And there are other people who are living in exile, specifically anyone 37 years old or younger, who have never been to Jerusalem, who don't know anything about Judah. People, Zedekiah, Jerusalem, those are just stories that their parents and their grandparents tell. 37 years go by, half a generation. And then you get this paragraph. This is the way that Jeremiah ends, 37 years later. In the 37th year of the exile of Jehoiachin, king of Judah, in the year Awalmarduk became the king of Babylon, on the 25th day of the 12th month, he released the king of Babylon, he released Jehoiachin, king of Judah, and freed him from prison. He spoke kindly to him and gave him a seat of honor higher than those of the other kings who were with him in Babylon. Judah's not the only kingdom that's been brought into exile. So Jehoiachin put aside his prison clothes and for the rest of his life ate regularly at the king's table. Day by day, the king of Babylon gave Jehoiachin a regular allowance as long as he lived till the day of his death. And that's the end of the book. Kind of a weird ending, isn't it? It's okay to say that, even if it's the Bible, but you can still say that. I mean, it's just not the way you expected the story to end. I mean, it's not exactly a happy ending. You know, the people of Judah, they're still living in exile. Nobody's been restored. All the promises that God had made, those remain unfulfilled. So it's not exactly a happy ending. But it's not exactly a terrible ending either. I mean, it's not an ending that's just filled with despair. In the story of Jehoiachin, there's this little glimpse, this little hint of hope that maybe God is going to be faithful to what he promised. It's just that the story hasn't finished yet. And it's just a little glimpse of hope. And here's what I've discovered. If I've got just even a little bit of hope, I can hold on no matter what I'm facing. So it's just this little bit of hope that maybe God is going to be faithful. The story isn't over yet. And what the people are left to do is to listen and to wait. And 600 years go by. 600 years of listening and waiting. And during those 600 years, a lot of things happen. The people, Babylon is eventually defeated, and the people of Judah are allowed to return back to Jerusalem, and they begin to rebuild their lives and to do their best to rebuild the city. But the promises that God had made about a new day and a new covenant and this new way that he's going to live with his people, none of that has been fulfilled. And so they keep listening and they keep waiting for the story to have an ending. 600 years go by. And then Jesus shows up on the scene. And he starts teaching, and he starts talking in ways that suggest that through him, that God is writing the end of the story. Jesus teaches, and he talks in a way that suggests that through him, God's kingdom is being established, that through him, the promises that God had made through Jeremiah of this new covenant, of this new day, are beginning to be fulfilled. Jesus loved to, we've seen this throughout the series, Jesus loved to use images and language that we find in Jeremiah. And Jesus also loved to tell God's story by telling other stories. On one occasion, he told three stories together about things that were lost. And if you want to follow us in the New Testament, in Luke's gospel, in the 15th chapter. And Jesus tells three stories about things that were lost. The first one was a lost sheep. And he tells a story about how a shepherd leaves the 99 sheep behind to go find the one lost sheep. And how when he brings him back home, there's this great party, this huge celebration. The second story is about a woman who has 10 coins and she loses one of them. And so she turns her house upside down trying to find this lost coin. And when she finds it, she also just has this time of just great rejoicing and celebration. And then the third story is about a lost son. And if you've been around church for a while, it's probably a story that you have heard before. And it's just such a powerful story. And in a way, it's Judah's story, and it's our story. And so I wanted to look at that story just for a moment together this morning. There are actually two sons in the story. There's the younger son that the story's going to focus around, but there's also an older son, the firstborn son. And he is, how many of you are firstborn kids? Anybody? I am. Anybody else? Firstborn kids? Okay, you will get this. The firstborn son is practically perfect in every way. And we get that, right? Never disobeys his father, never breaks the rules, always does what's expected to him, takes on all the firstborns. Agree with me, right? Amen? Yeah. Amen. If you're a firstborn, you probably have a younger brother or sister. Yeah, you know what they're like, right? Spoiled little brats that get away with it. And y'all know it, those of you who are, that describes, and you know it. And that's the other son in this story. And this second son, he is the source of every sleepless night his dad has ever had. He is the reason for every gray hair that's left on his poor dad's balding head, because he keeps pulling his hair out over what to do with this kid. So Jesus tells a story about these two sons, but the story's focused on the second son. One day the second son comes to his dad, and he makes a request of him. He says, Dad, I want my share of the estate, my inheritance, and I'd like to have it now. Now, we kind of read that, and we don't get how heavy of a statement that really is. In Jesus' day, for a son to ask his father for his share of the estate is essentially to tell his dad that, "Dad, I wish you were dead so that I could go ahead and have what's coming to me." It is about as harsh and as cruel as anything that a son could say to his father. But in the story, the dad relents and he gives his son exactly what he asked for. And the son sets off with now his share of the estate in his hands. He sets off for a foreign country. And Jesus doesn't include this in the story. But if you were to have asked the son, "What power are you trusting in?" He'd have said real quickly, "Money. And I've got plenty of it. And this is my security for the rest of my life. And now I am just off to live life large and to enjoy it. The power I'm trusting in is money." But what he discovers is that money won't sustain him. And he winds up in the story, he winds up in this distant land, and he just blows through the money. He squanders it. He loses everything. And he wakes up one day and he's just at the lowest of low. He's actually in a pig pen, literally with lying with the pigs, feeding pigs. And he comes to his senses. And Jesus tells the story this way. He said he comes to his senses and he says to himself, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands, like one of your servants.'" And so he set off and went to his father. Now, here's where I see his story being so like Judah's, the story we've read throughout Jeremiah. I mean, both this son and the people of Judah find themselves living in captivity in a foreign land. In a sense, they both wind up in exile. They took different paths to get there, but they had this in common. Both Judah and the son in this story turn their backs on someone who loves them. A God who wanted nothing more than for Judah to return to him. A father who loves his son despite his son's rebellious ways. Both Judah and the son in this story turn their backs on the one who loves them, and they find themselves living in captivity. For Judah, remember, again, we've seen this throughout the summer, it's as if they had been betting their existence, betting their very lives, that their political alliances or their worship practices or the foreign gods that they would chase, they're kind of betting their lives that would save them. For the son, he's betting his life that he was going to have money enough to sustain himself no matter what came his way. They both bet, they both gambled, they both lost. And so now the son in the story decides to bet his life on something different. He decides to bet his very existence, to bet his life on his father's capacity to forgive, on his dad's love and grace and mercy. And so one day he wakes up and he decides, I'm going to bet my life on dad, and I'm going to go home. And I think what happens next in the story, this is some of the most beautiful images, one of the most beautiful images in the Bible. It says in Luke 15, verse 20, Jesus says, "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him." And this isn't at all what the son expected. Remember what he said? He's kind of expecting, at best, "I'll bet my life that dad will welcome me home, but probably just as a servant. But I've got nowhere else to turn, so I bet my life that at least if I go home, there'll be food to eat and a place to sleep and somewhere to lay my head at night. There'll be a little bit of shelter. I mean, at least I'll be taken back in." He's betting his life on that, but he never expected how his dad would wait, had been waiting for him. He never expected how his dad would respond. And I love this. You notice what the dad does when he sees his son? He runs to him and he grabs him in his arms and he hugs him and he kisses him and he doesn't say, all right, how about a little apology here? Instead, the dad says, just like with the lost sheep and the lost coin, the dad says, let's have a party. Verse 22, the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and now he's found. And so they began to celebrate. I mean, isn't that a great story? This is the ending to Judah's story. And most importantly, this is our story. Yours and mine. Because here's the truth, and we don't like to admit this, but we've talked about this throughout the summer. When we ask the question, what power do I trust? We know the answer is supposed to be God. We're supposed to trust Jesus with our lives. But the truth is, when we really look at the way we live our lives, things that we give our full attention, the things that we put our priorities in, the things that we are trusting, we tend to trust everything else. I praying with a guy between the services. He'd been in the earlier service, and he's telling me his story and how he had spent most of his life trusting success. Just kind of trying to build a life of success. And when that wasn't enough, he decided to trust a relationship, and then that relationship just fell apart on him in these last couple of months. But this is what we do. We trust all the powers of the world. And people do this. We usually don't turn our backs on God in big, spectacular ways. We often do it in just very small, everyday kind of ways. And so we put our trust in relationships and other people, thinking we'll find our security there. Or we put our trust in money. A lot of people do this. We put our trust in politics, just like Judah did. We have an election year coming up. I talk to a lot of people who are just convinced if we can put the right people into office, the world's going to be fine. We put our trust in health. We put our trust in success. We put our trust in our possessions. We put our trust in all of these lesser things. And they always disappoint us. And if we're really honest with the question, what power am I trusting in, and the ways in which we live our lives, we're a lot like Judah and a lot like the son in this story. We're trusting in all of these lesser things. But what might it look like in your life if you were to bet your life on the love and the grace and the forgiveness of your Heavenly Father? What might it look like if you put all of your trust in a God who loves you so much that it doesn't matter what you've done or where you've been or how distant of the land that you've run away to, he's just waiting to welcome you home, and he'll run to you if you'll take a step toward him. What might it look like to bet your life on Jesus? We've heard such beautiful promises throughout the study of Jeremiah. And they were spoken to the people of Judah, but they are spoken also to you and to me. God says, don't be afraid, don't be dismayed. I will surely save you out of a distant place. If you feel like you're in a distant place this morning, and maybe you feel further from God than you know you should be. God says, don't be afraid, don't be dismayed. I'll surely save you out of a distant place. I'll bring you from the land of exile. Not because of anything that you've done. Not because you've got it all figured out or you're doing the right steps or the right practices or going through the right motions. God says, I'm going to do it just out of a heart of love that's greater than anything you can imagine. Again, he said this to Judah, but he says it to you and to me. God says, I will surely save you because I've loved you with an everlasting love. And I have drawn you to me with unfailing kindness. My love for you will never, ever fail. Because this is God's promise to you and to me. He says, I will be your God, and you will be my sons and my daughters. And no longer will you teach your neighbor or your brother or your sister, and you won't tell them, know the Lord, because all of you, from the least of you to the greatest, will know me, because I will welcome you home. And you can bet your life on that. Earlier this summer, one of my daughters, she works at a church over in Atlanta, and she introduced me to a song that they were using for their high school ministry there. Song by the group Imagine Dragons. Some of y'all may know that band. And the song's called Bet My Life. And the writer of the song, Dan Reynolds, says that he wrote it as a way to kind of tell his parents, I'm sorry for what a horrible kid I was and all that I put you through when I was in high school. And some of us get that, because maybe that was us during our high school years. And but the first time I heard the song, I thought, man, this is the song of the story that Jesus told about this lost son. And the more I listened to the song, the more that I thought, man, this song is about God's story to Judah through Jeremiah. And more importantly, again, this song is about our story with God and what it looks like when we put our trust in him. And so the band's going to come back out, and I've asked them if they would do the song for us this morning. And as they do, what I want you to do, it really is just a beautiful, beautiful song. And I encourage you to listen to the song. And I promise you, as you hear it, you'll hear the story that Jesus told. And if you'll listen, you'll hear echoes of Judah's story that we've discovered through Jeremiah as well. But here's what I'd really invite you to listen to as they perform this song for us. I want you to listen to hear your story in the midst of it. And what God may want to say to you this morning. And what it might look like for you to come home and for you to bet your life on his love.
I know I took the path that you would never want for me. I know I let you down tonight. So many sleepless nights when you were waiting up on me. I'm just a slave until the night. I remember when I told you that's the last you'll see. Remember when I broke you down to tears. I know I took the path that you would never want to be. I gave you hell through all the years. Done. So,
guys. Here's the deal. Here's what we've seen all throughout Jeremiah. You can bet your life on the powers of this world, and they're always going to disappoint you. You can bet your life on political alliances, relationships, money, success, whatever it might be. And none of those things will ever bring you life. Or you can make a decision to bet your life on Jesus and on this better way to live that he came to show us, and on this way in which we could live forever to him that he makes possible for each and every one of us. And all that's required is a decision. All that's required is to say, Jesus, I want to come home. And what you'll discover is that he's waiting, and his arms are open, and he'll run to greet you, and he'll welcome you, and there'll be a celebration. He tells us a celebration in heaven every time one of us decides that we would come back home and that we would bet our life on him. And again, it may be that you've turned your back on him, not in spectacular ways, but just in little ways, trusting after the powers of this world, chasing after these lesser powers and gods in our life. But maybe today, I can't think of a better day. Maybe today is the day that it's time for you to decide, I don't want to do that anymore. It's time to wake up and come to your senses, to bet your life on Jesus and to come back home. We're going to sing one more song together in a moment, and it's a song that gives us a chance to proclaim that we're the daughters and we're the sons of God, and nothing could ever separate us from the love of a God who just invites us, always invites us to come home to him. And as we sing that song, if today is the day that you're ready to make that decision, and again, I can't think of a better day, a decision to bet your life on Jesus, to take a next step toward trusting him and his power fully in your life. Now, I'm going to be standing down front, and as we sing, would you just come forward? And all that will happen, I'll give you a hug, and I'll give you a little card that helps you discover some next steps that you might take just to point you in the right direction. But just as a way of publicly saying, I'm ready to bet my life on Jesus, as we sing this song together, I invite you to come forward. Again, I can't think of a better day than today to do that. But first, would you pray with me? Lord, thank you for the word, the truth that you have spoken to the prophet Jeremiah, to each one of us this summer. Thank you for the reminders that no matter how far we fall, no matter how deep in exile we may be, no matter how long we've been away from you, that you always wait for us. That you call us to return to you and to discover the life that you came to bring, a life that is truly life. Lord Jesus, I know that there's some in the room this morning, just as it were at the last hour. There are some in this room right now who need to take that step of faith, who need to return to you and to take hold of this life. And so I pray that we, as we sang earlier about being brave and having courage, that you'd give them the courage to come forward and to make that decision now, to come forward and to bet their life on the power of your love. For we pray that in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand and we're going to sing together.
Before he spoke creation, the God of heaven knew our names. And formed in his reflection, we are his glory on display. And his heart is good, he is always kind. With a cross he came, he is on my side. We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. No matter where we go, we're close to the Father's heart.
We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. His love he lavished on us and called us children of the King. And in his loving kindness, he chose the lowly and the weak. And his heart is good, he is always with a cross he proved, he is on our side. We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. No matter where we go, it goes to the Father's heart.
Pray together. Lord, we are your daughters, we're your sons, and we believe what we have sung, Lord, that you will never forsake us, that you will always welcome us home. Help us to share that good news Help us to make it a reality in our own lives. Help us to proclaim it from this mountaintop that we are your sons and your daughters. And your love for us will never fail. We trust our lives in the power of that love alone. And we do that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. But before you leave this morning, if you're kind of at a place in your life that there's just stuff going on and you'd like someone to pray with you or to pray for you, we have a prayer team. They've been praying for us during the last hour, and they're available now to pray with you, and sometimes that's just the blessing you need on a Sunday. So they'll be off to my left in our prayer and care room as soon as the service is over. And for the rest of us, as we head out into the week and into the places where we live and work and play and go to school, remember that we never leave here alone. And my prayer for you each week is that our living Lord Jesus Christ, that he'd go with you. May he go above you to watch over you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, within you to give you peace, and before you to show you his way, now and forevermore. Amen. Hey, if you're a part of Mountaintop Online this morning, we are so glad you get to be a part of the church this way. Maybe you went away for Labor Day weekend and this was your way to stay connected. Or you may be part of our ongoing Mountaintop Church Online community. Either way, we are so glad you got to be part of the church this service. Understand we had a little technical trouble last hour, so I hope you tuned in for the whole hour this week. Anyway, we love you. We hope you have a blessed week. And we'll see you next Sunday. Take care.